Hello and a very warm welcome to today's service from the Church of Christ the King. You are most welcome. We're delighted that you have joined us today. Whether it be for the first time, whether you've been a church member for many, many years, whether you're exploring faith or have been a Christian for a long, long time, wherever you find yourself, whether you worship alone, whether you worship as a group, you are most welcome indeed to the service today. My name's Patrick. I'm the curate here at Christ the King. And we, of course, worship God in spirit and truth. We worship him at home. We worship in the church building too as well. Many of you know now that we've been meeting back in church for a number of weeks, back in the church building. And please do sign up for either the 10 o'clock or the 4 o'clock service, should you feel that's something that you can do. The 4 o'clock service run by Joe and Andy is aimed at families. It's called One Life. And you can register for that via the church website, as you can do the 10 o'clock. But as I've just said, wherever we worship as one body. Later in the service, Eleanor, our associate vicar, will unpack God's word. She'll be talking about what this thing called faith is. What's this thing called faith? You'll also be aware that she is just starting her sabbatical as well. So we do wish her well. Please do pray for her. Pray that her reading and her study goes well. Pray that she gets time of rest and reflection. And may she know God in greater depth over this time. She will be missed, but we are delighted that she has got some time to rest. Of course, as part of our identity in faith, part of our identity in Jesus, we recognise that we sometimes take the wrong path. The Bible calls it sin. As part of our faith, it's right and proper that we recognise where we have gone wrong and we turn to God via his Son Jesus Christ to ask for forgiveness. So let's start right now in remembering where we have fallen short in our relationship with God, fallen short in our relationships with family and friends, fallen short with our relationship with others. So in faith, let us confess, and the response will come up on screen. Lord Jesus, you wept over the sins of your city, on our city. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Lord Jesus, you heal the wounds of sin and division, jealousy and bitterness. So on us, Christ, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord Jesus, you bring pardon and peace to the sinner. Grant us peace. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. So may the God of all healing and forgiveness draw you to himself and cleanse you from all your sins, that you may behold the glory of his Son, the Word made flesh, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. So as God's free, forgiven and renewed people, let's worship him as the God we can trust with all our heart and with all our strength. Let's worship. Thank you.
My hope is in you alone. I call on you, my God, for you will answer me. Turn your ears to me and hear my prayer. Show me the wonders of your great love, you who save, by your right hand those who take refuge in you from their foes. I call on you, my God, you will answer me. Now faith is confidence in what we hope for, and assurance about what we do not see.
Be still and know that I am God. Be still and know that I am God. Be still and know that I am God.
The apostles said to the Lord, increase our faith. Increase our faith.
To come and answer a question for you all. And that question is, what is faith? Well, the Bible tells us that faith means being sure of the things we hope for, and faith means knowing that something is real, even if we do not see it. But do you know what? Faith is not about us. It's not about you. It's not about me. But it's about what we are putting our faith in. Or rather, who we are putting our faith in. I want to show you something this morning. Can you see that? Look, imagine that is faith. It's not very big, is it? In fact, it's really quite tiny. And let's say I have faith in purple unicorns stamping through Kettering tomorrow. If I think I believe that, I might put faith in it. I might even tell other people about it. But if my faith is based in purple unicorns, well, it doesn't really do very much, does it? It just falls flat. It goes a bit cloudy. That's about it. But on the other hand, let's say I place my faith in something that is worthwhile and actually has power. Let's say that this is God. Now, if I have faith in God's words, it does not take much on my part for amazing things to happen. Look at that, it's rising. So amazing, amazing things happen. The faith itself was not as important, was it, as what we put our faith in. And that is what Jesus was talking about when he said that faith could be as tiny as a mustard seed, but could move mountains. We don't actually have to do anything special to grow our faith. We just need to get to know Jesus better every single day. And we have to know and accept what God has already done for us. We might not see God with our eyes, might we? But we know what he has done and continues to do, because we trust that the Bible is true and it comes from God. Now that is what faith is. Back to the studio.
Well, I have here with me Eleanor, which comes as no surprise because we often see Eleanor. But Eleanor, as of today, you're going off on sabbatical.
I am.
How long is that going to be for?
3 months.
3 months. Mm-hmm. That means you're not back till February.
That's right.
2021,
not 22, just 21.
Oh, that's a relief. Oh. Okay. So what are you hoping to do during that time?
Well, I mean, the first thing to say is sabbatical is a chance to rest. It's a chance to see God and often to do a project of some sort. It's not just a holiday, although there will be times of holiday in there. I'm planning to be away a little bit. I'm planning to go on retreat and do various things like that. My big project is that I'm going to be filming my talks for a course that I wrote for churches called Securely Single. Mm-hmm. The title gives it away what it's about. And to build a website for that, because there's lots of people across the country who I know want the resource. So I want to try and get that up and running for people to use. I'm going to spend some time trying to seek God and just work out what he's saying to me as well.
Sounds really good. And you've sort of answered the question, but how can we be praying for you?
I think it's interesting, isn't it? Because this year has been a very difficult year for a lot of people, and I'm not alone in this, but I'm quite tired and just having some time to rest, so prayer for good rest would be great. There's also something about the fact that God calls us, and I feel like I need a real fresh understanding of how God is calling me and who I am in him, and just to readdress that sort of thing. And the other thing is that, of course, I have my plans, God has his, and at the moment, who knows what's going to happen in the next 3 months. So that I am able to work through and deal with and cope with whatever comes, and that God will have his way, because that's the most important thing.
Sounds good. Well, we wish you well. We will be praying for you.
Thank you.
And I would say, do think of us, but actually the idea of a sabbatical is you try and stop thinking about us, and have a great time. And we will miss you enormously, won't we? But we'll look forward to seeing you again very soon. Bless you.
Thank you.
Dear Lord Jesus, thank you for your love for us. Thank you that we can talk to you and you listen to what we say. We are sorry when we do or say things that you don't like. Please forgive us and help us to try our best not to do them again. Thank you for our families and friends. Please help us to look after each other. Thank you for the half-term holiday that we've just enjoyed. We pray for the children and teachers as they go back to school tomorrow. Please keep them safe as they start their term up to Christmas. Thank you for the doctors and nurses and carers who are looking after people who are ill and poorly, particularly those with COVID-19. Thank you also for all the key workers who are working very hard to keep us safe. Thank you for the world that we live in. Help us to look after it and keep it clean for everyone to enjoy. We pray for our government and leaders. Please help them to make decisions which are fair for all of us. And we pray for those who are homeless at this time. Please keep them safe throughout the winter and show us ways we can help those who need our support. Amen.
Today's reading comes from Hebrews 11, verses 1 to 13. Now faith has been sure of what we hope for, and certain of what we do not see. This is what the ancients were commended for. By faith, we understand the universe was formed as God commanded, so that what is seen was not made out of what was visible. By faith, Abel offered God a better sacrifice than Cain did. By faith, he commanded a righteous man when God spoke well of his offerings. And by faith, he still speaks even though he is dead. By faith, Enoch was taken from this life, so he did not experience death. He could not be found because God had taken him away. But before he was taken, he was commended as one who pleased God. And without faith, it is impossible to please God, because anyone who comes to him must believe that he exists, and he rewards those who earnestly seek him. By faith, Noah was warned about the things not yet seen. In holy fear, built an ark to save his family. By his faith, he condemned the world and became heir of the righteousness that comes by faith. By faith, Abraham was called to go into a place he would later receive as his inheritance, obeyed and went, even though he did not know where he was going. By faith, he made his home in the promised land like a stranger in a foreign country. He lived in tents, as did Isaac and Jacob, who were heirs with him of the same promise, for he was looking forward to the city with foundations, whose architect and builder is God. By faith, Abraham, even though was past age, and Sarah herself was barren, was enabled to become a father because he considered him faithful who had made the promise. And so from this one man, being as good as dead, came descendants as numerous as the stars in the sky, and as countless as the sand on the seashore. All these people were still living by faith when they died. They did not receive the things promised. They only saw them and welcomed them from a distance, and they admitted they were aliens and strangers on earth. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Today's reading is taken from Luke chapter 17, verses 1 to 6. Jesus says to his disciples, "Things that cause people to stumble are bound to come, but woe to anyone for whom they come. It would be better for them to be thrown into the sea with a millstone tied around their neck than to cause one of these little ones to stumble. So watch yourselves. If your brother or sister sins against you, rebuke them, and if they repent, forgive them. Even if they sin against you 7 times in a day, and 7 times come back to you saying, 'I repent,' you must forgive them." The apostles said to the Lord, "Increase our faith." He replied, "If you have faith as small as a mustard seed, you can say to this mulberry tree, 'Be uprooted and planted in the sea,' and it will obey you." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Good morning. I've got a story to tell you. A story, it's about a nun who was working for a local home health care agency, and she was out making her rounds one day when she ran out of petrol. As luck would have it, there was a station just round the corner. So she walked to the petrol station to borrow a can with enough petrol to start the car and drive it to the petrol station for a proper fill-up. When she got there, though, the attendant told her, "I'm really sorry, but the one can we own has just been loaned out. Do stick around, though, because it'll be back quite soon, I'm sure." Since the nun was on the way to see a patient, she decided not to wait, and she walked back to her car. But after looking through her car for something to carry to the petrol station to fill with petrol, she spotted a bedpan, and so she took that to the petrol station because she was very resourceful, and she filled it with petrol and carried it back to her car. As she was pouring the petrol into the tank of the car, 2 men walked by. One of them turned to the other and said, "Now that is what I call faith." Sorry, apologies for that joke. You'll miss me, really. I think we should pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for the opportunity to think about you now. And as we look at these Bible passages, help us to seek you and to hear you. Come by your Holy Spirit and inspire each one of us. In Jesus' name, amen. So we're thinking about faith today. Milton Jones says this about faith. "Faith is like standing still in the noise, knowing that the bus is coming. And occasionally, through the fog and the traffic, catching a glimpse of something big and red." When we think about faith, the fact is that whether we are Christians or not, we all have faith every single day. When you get in your car, you have faith that it will work, that the wheels won't fall off. When you eat a meal, you will have faith that it won't be poisoned. When you go for a walk, you have faith that the law of gravity means that you won't suddenly find yourself floating in midair. But you probably don't think those things all the time, do you? They become second nature. You're living out faith all the time, whoever you are. Milton Jones describes a bit more than that bus stop that he was talking about in that earlier example. He says this: "Some of the others waiting might give up. Or maybe they'll decide that they can make the journey on their own. Or that there is actually no journey, that the bus stop is all there is, a bench and a shelter with a single training shoe lying on the roof. It's just the way things are." I wonder where you are with faith today. Are you full of faith? Or are you unsure? Are you searching? Maybe you're being challenged in your faith at this moment. Well, I hope, and maybe I should say I have faith, that there will be something that I say today that will help. So let's think about this question that we've been given today then. What is this thing called faith? Well, the great thing is that the writer to the Hebrews, who wrote one of our passages today, gives us a definition. And he's basically saying, well, let me give you a description of faith in action. And he gives this description, and actually he gives us quite a good definition, really. He says, beginning of chapter 11, "Now faith is confidence in what we hope for and assurance about what we do not see." I'm a sinful soul. I am sinful as well, but I am simple. And I really like the International Children's Bible version, which says this: "Faith means being sure of the things we hope for. And faith means knowing that something is real, even if we do not see it." A friend of mine says it like this: "Faith is the conscious belief and trust in the coming Messiah. Forward-looking belief. Hope." Forward-looking belief, I like that. So for Christians, faith is far more than the daily living and trusting in the stuff around us. It is forward-looking belief. It is a hope. It is a certain hope. It's a conscious belief that Jesus will one day return, that we will one day be with him in eternity. And for all of that, what that means for today, as we've thought about recently, that is faith. So if we look at all of that, faith is confidence. It's assurance. It's being sure. It's trusting in something even when we can't see it. And I believe it makes or should make a difference to how we live our lives. So I want us to think this morning about those two words which help define faith. The first of those is confidence. So we can say that faith is confidence in what is hoped for. This reading from Hebrews 11 we've had this morning is an incredible list and description of many of the people of God in the Old Testament. And each one is introduced with the phrase, "by faith." And then the writer goes on to talk about them. And these examples in Hebrews 11 show the firm confidence that these people of faith had in the promises of God. Even though if we look to the end of the chapter, verse 39, we see that none of them saw all the fulfillment of the promises in their lifetime. That is particularly because the writer was referring to the promise of the coming Messiah, of Jesus. Because, of course, all these characters were in the Old Testament before the incarnation of Jesus. But many of them had received promises from God. Think of Noah, who's described in this passage, and Abraham, and Sarah. I love what it says about Sarah in verse 11. It says this: "She considered him faithful who had made the promise." If we think of Sarah then, she had been promised offspring, if you remember back to Genesis. And it was seeing God who made the promise as the one who was faithful. So we could say that faith is about a confidence in God's faithfulness. Even when we might be lacking faith, it's all about confidence in God's faithfulness. It's about who we have faith in. And I wonder how that feels to you today. It's often only when we look back, isn't it, that we see God's promises coming to fruition. The Bible is full of God's promises. We read in the Bible that God says he will never leave us, that we have a hope and a future, that we will be with him in eternity. We read in John's Gospel that Jesus promised before he died that he would send his Spirit to be with us. And many of us would testify to knowing that promise being fulfilled, for example. But it's a good reminder, isn't it, that faith isn't of our own doing. It's about the one we put our faith in, as you saw my cousin show you earlier. So that's the first thing. Faith is confidence in what is hoped for. The second thing is that faith is assurance in what is unseen. It's an active thing. The sort of assurance that isn't firm dogmatism, but a certainty about what is not seen, which compels and leads to action and in our lives lived. The people described in Hebrews 11, for example, show this assurance in acting in ways which lived out their assurance, that faith. So Noah believed what God said about what was not seen, and it led him to action. Enoch pleased God because of faith. He believed God existed, even though he couldn't see him. And it says in the passage, "And without faith, it is impossible to please God, because anyone who comes to him must believe that he exists." So faith is living a life in a way that shows the assurance in something we cannot see. But I would add that it's not a blind faith, because there is so much evidence out there. We've talked about that in previous weeks. We see the evidence of God in creation. One example which, of course, Hebrews uses in verse 3. By faith, he says, we understand that the universe was formed at God's command, so that what is seen was not made out of what was visible. We have the evidence of faith in lives changed. We have the evidence of faith in signs and wonders who show God at work, and so on and so forth. So faith is confidence in what is hoped for. It is assurance in what is unseen. And I want to add one final thing, actually, which I believe is that faith makes a difference. It makes a difference in how we live our lives. In every example of Hebrews 11, faith makes a difference. But we see it too in the other reading, with the example of Jesus and his disciples talking about forgiveness. After hearing all this stuff about forgiveness, the apostles say to Jesus, increase our faith. And then he replies, if you have faith as small as a mustard seed, you can say to this mulberry tree, be uprooted and planted in the sea, and it will obey you. It's a slightly strange thing for Jesus to say, but what's happened is that the apostles, the disciples, think that forgiving it again and again, which happens in the earlier verses in this passage, means that they need more faith, that they cannot do it by their own. I want to share with you a few words from Tom Wright. And he says this. It's not great faith you need. It is faith in a great God. Faith is like a window through which you can see something. What matters is not whether the window is 6 inches or 6 feet high. What matters is the God that your faith is looking out on. If it's the Creator God, the God active in Jesus and the Spirit, then the tiniest little peephole of a window will give you access to power that you never dreamed of. Of course, this cannot be used for your own whim or pleasure, he adds. As soon as you tried, you would show that you'd forgotten once more who this God really was. Faith can make a difference in our lives. Faith is about who we put our faith in. Evidenced by all of these people in Hebrews 11. Evidence in the way that it enables us to forgive again and again and again. It's not about an increase in faith, but about who we put our faith in. We can have the tiniest amount of faith. Let's remember that God is faithful. So it's not about what we do. It's not about what we try and make happen. Faith is about who we put our faith in. And that got me thinking. Because sometimes someone might say to you, well, I wish I had your faith. I wonder whether you've ever had someone say that to you. Well, it's interesting. And I wonder how you respond to that question. For me, by looking at this passage and thinking about faith in this last week, I've been wondering about how I should respond to that question. I've realised that maybe how I should respond is to say, you should know the one I have faith in. It's not about me. You may know this mnemonic, but it's worth repeating because I think it helps us to remember it. Forsaking all, I trust him. It's about him. It's about trusting him. It's not about anything else. It's about trusting Jesus. But I do want to add, though, that it can be really intimidating, can't it, when we look at these characters, for example, in Hebrews 11, and just what they had faced, yet that they did all of this by faith. And we can do the same when we look at others and think, well, why do they seem to have more faith than me? We can join in with the disciples and ask Jesus for more faith, when the small amount we have is enough. Because our faith is in the Creator of the universe. But I want to add that we can look later on in this chapter and see that they didn't have it easy. In fact, the final part of chapter 11 gives us a pretty tough picture of what some of these people of faith in the Old Testament faced. To top it all off, as I've said already, even they hadn't even received what was promised because Jesus hadn't yet come. But it can be intimidating, can't it? And so I want to challenge you today to think about what all of this means for your life. If you haven't put your faith and trust in Jesus, why not do it today? It doesn't mean that life will be easier or anything like that, but it means putting your faith in someone who keeps his promises and who will bring you eternal life and who will be at work in you more and more each day. If you have put your faith in Jesus, then what are you waiting for? What is stopping you? You probably know that the fact that I quite often like to talk about context of a passage, because it's really important, seeing what's going on around something that we read. And this passage in Hebrews 11, which is often thought of a hall of fame, is sandwiched between two passages that say something similar. Chapter 10, at the end of it, it says this: "You need to persevere so that when you have done the will of God, you will receive what he promised. For in just a little while, he who is coming will come and will not delay. And, but my righteous one will live by faith, and I take no pleasure in the one who shrinks back. But we do not belong to those who shrink back and are destroyed, but to those who have faith and are saved." That passage is about persevering through tough times, persevering because of faith. Then if we look to chapter 12, the other side of our reading, the beginning of it says this: "Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses," that is those mentioned in chapter 11 and others, of course, "let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles, and let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of faith. For the joy set before him, he endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who endured such opposition from sinners, so that you will not grow weary and lose heart." Fact is that it is so easy, isn't it, to grow weary and lose heart, to doubt, to look at others and think, well, they've got it and I haven't. But I want to encourage you today to keep going. Elsewhere in Hebrews, we're reminded that he who promised is faithful. His promises are yes and amen, it says elsewhere as well. These times are hard. They're challenging. We can easily be tripped up and get entangled by sin and the world around us, to shrink away even from God. But I want to challenge you today to keep your eyes fixed on Jesus. He is the author and the perfecter of your faith. It's about him. Run with perseverance, seeking him, knowing that God by his Spirit is with you, helping you, equipping you. One example for you. I was chatting to someone recently about the fact that it is very easy when you're watching the service online to allow other things to get in the way of worshipping Jesus, and therefore keeping your eyes fixed on him is hard. Things like the gardening or the phone, social media. It's easy to think, oh, I'll watch that another time. It's easy to get so out of the habit and the practice so that one week we're not engaging turns to 2 weeks or to three or four and so on. But in these times we need to keep persevering in our faith, to hold on to the fact that God is faithful, to be reminded of who he is week in, week out. Let's keep persevering. Remember that our faith, even if it's small, is not about us, it's about who we're putting our faith in. As you know, I'm off on sabbatical, so I want to say at the end of all of this that I will be praying that every single one of you keeps going, that you see God at work, that you grow closer to him in this time, as I hope I do as well. And I look forward to hearing the stories of what has happened. Amen.
Thank you very much indeed, Eleanor. So, where are you with your faith today? Does your faith give you hope? Does your faith give you belief? And what are you putting your faith in today? So let's pray now for three things mentioned by Eleanor: that we have confidence in Jesus, that we have assurance in Jesus, and that this makes a difference in our lives. So we ask for a renewal of our faith via the Holy Spirit now. Come, Holy Spirit, renew our faith. Give us confidence in Jesus. Give us assurance in Jesus, especially in these difficult times. And we know that will make a difference in our lives. We present ourselves to you once again today, Lord Jesus, afresh. Be with us today and always. And we also ask for courage and for strength for those who don't know Jesus yet to step forward. And I'm sure we know people who we can be alongside at this time. We pray for the right words. We pray for faith for those people. And if you're sitting at home or you're contemplating having faith in Jesus for the first time and wondering what that looks like, please do get in touch. And please do open your heart right now and just ask Jesus to come into your life. I'm sorry for the things that I have done wrong. I want to believe and be alongside you, Jesus, today and always. And as Eleanor said, in these times, we need to persevere in our faith, to hold on to the fact that God is faithful, to be reminded of who He is, week in, week out, through our prayer life, through reading our Bibles, and through engaging with each other. So if anything rings true to you today, if anything that has been said has prompted you to engage, then please do. The details will come up later in the service. Please do get in touch. So we now come to our final song. Let's once again open our hearts. Let's give thanks for the faith and the identity that we have in and through Jesus. Let's worship.
Your faith can move the mountains. Let the mountains move. We come with expectation, waiting here for you. My heart, the author of salvation.
as you all know, we are looking towards the end of the year, and that obviously means Advent and the Christmas season. Of course, that's going to look a little bit different for us this year, but we also want to bring some comfort and joy through carols this season. Now, we're not going to be able to do that in a major way in the church building. We just can't have the numbers in for a carol service. But what we are going to do is take a series of smaller carol events out into the Ice Lodge estate. And we have Stuart Welsh and David Lee here to talk to us about that.
What are we going to do about Christmas this year, Stuart?
I know, we can't do the carol service because of COVID, but what can we do?
How about this?
Mm-hmm.
Instead of everyone coming to the church and having a service,
yeah.
How about if we get a group together and take the service out to the community?
I love it.
Let's have a group of six singers.
Yeah.
And somebody who can give a short talk.
Yeah.
And we can take it round the estate.
I love it, I love it. And it could be from the 14th to the 23rd of December.
Excellent.
Yeah. And we could go out and do two of these little services each evening.
Yeah, yeah.
That would be fantastic. But to do it, we would need to get these groups of singers together.
We would, yes. Now, I put together a choir in the past.
You have.
I know there's lots of singers in church.
There are.
So I think all they need to do is send an email into the church office.
Perfect.
Email address and say that they can volunteer for any of the nights. So we can get six singers going around twice. That'll be fantastic each night.
That'll be fantastic. And people wouldn't need to sign up for every night.
No.
They could sign up for one night or two nights or as many nights as they'd like to volunteer for.
Yes. I'm sure we've got enough singers in the church.
I'm absolutely certain you're right. So, what we'd love you to do is to send an email into the church office and let us know if you'd like to be part of these groups of carolers that are going to go out and take the blessing of a service into our community this Christmas.
Hey, Stuart, it's a great hat, you know.
Oh, thank you very much, David. I must tell you where I bought it.
Thank you, Stuart, and thank you, David. It sounds really excited, and of course, everybody do look out for these events and for more information as it comes through. So now our final blessing. May the light of Christ, the King of all, shine ever brighter in our hearts, that with all the saints in light, we may shine forth as light in the world. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen.